release our receipt on this Holy Thursday. Please stand now and join with me in singing our opening hymn, Glory in the Cross, found in today's Missal number 40, number 40 in today's Missal. Only the Thursday verses.
Yesterday morning, united with the priests and in the presence of the people of the Diocese of Orlando, Bishop Noonan consecrated the sacred chrism and blessed oils for use in the sacrament of anointing of the sick and in the preparation of catechumens for baptisms. Tonight we receive these oils, which we will use in the celebration of the sacraments. By means of these powerful symbols, the crucified and risen Savior will continue in our midst the work he began in his death and resurrection, healing, forgiveness, and new life.
Behold the oil of the sick. May the sick who are anointed with this oil experience the compassion of Christ and his saving love in body and soul. Anointing with this oil, may our catechumens who preparing to receive the saving waters of baptism, be strengthened by Christ to resist the power of Satan and reject evil in all its forms. Behold the sacred chrism. Through anointing with this perfumed chrism, may children and adults who are baptized and confirmed, and priests who are ordained, experience the gracious gift of the Holy Spirit.
May these oils be for us a sign of the Holy Spirit sent by the risen Jesus to strengthen, refresh, and heal all who are called to be God's holy and priestly people. Amen.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers, as we prepare to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us open up our hearts and our lives to the healing mercy of God, which is ours in Christ. I confess
to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have grievously sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, and my mysterious fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon it the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one, and shall share in the lamb in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, and then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night they shall eat its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it: with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. You shall eat it like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt, I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with pilgrimage to the Lord, as a perpetual institution." The word of the Lord.
Our blessing come, is upon you.
reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Do this in memory of me. The Jewish feast of Passover, we know it, remembers the liberation of the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. In the book of Exodus, Tacitus tells us that the first Passover took place under a full moon, the first moon of the first month of the Jewish year, the month of Nisan. The full Nisan moon in the sky over Egypt, as Aaron and Moses and the people of Israel gathered together to eat the Passover lamb that had been roasted over the fire with bitter herbs and unleavened bread. And the blood sprinkled on the doorposts of the houses and marked out those who were to be saved. And the Lord God spoke, "This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all generations shall celebrate. For all generations you must celebrate it as a feast in the Lord's honor." In other words, do this in memory of me. And so it was the same full moon that shone almost 1,000 years later when Jesus gathered together with his disciples to celebrate the Passover meal in Jerusalem. They had gone to great lengths in preparing things and put everything in order, and even following the man with a jar of water on his head to the upper room and get everything ready there. And as we know, it did not unfold as it should have unfolded. What we see is while they were at table, Jesus took the bread, said the blessing, "Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation." He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples. So good so far, right? Everything according to tradition, kosher. And then he said it. As he offered that broken loaf, he said, "This is my body given up for you." Now imagine the shock of those around the Passover table. This was scandalous. And some of the disciples must have been stunned and said, "Did we hear this right?" And just after they've recovered perhaps their composure, he does it again. He takes the cup and says, "This is my blood, which will be poured out for you." And when he had said this, he passed the cup and said, "Do this in memory of me." This night would be filled with another surprise. Earlier on, before supper, he picked up a pail of water, a towel, and did what nobody would ever have foreseen. He washed their feet, and Peter strenuously objects, "Lord, you will never wash my feet. Stop it." Peter understands Jesus to be the Christ, because we know, he says, "Who do you say that I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." But this does not help him explain, understand the menial foot washing that was relegated to servants. In the desert, the devil tempted Jesus in a fashion not too differently from what Peter is doing. Because those temptations, in effect, said this: "You are equal to God, act like it." And this was so contrary to the understanding of who a Messiah would be, who someone is equal to God, to get on his knees. And remember, Peter also rejected Jesus' humility at another point in his ministry. When Jesus announces his passion, he's going to have to suffer, be rejected by the elders, put to death, and rise again. "This should never happen to you, Jesus." And Jesus' response, "Get behind me, Satan." Now Jesus warns Peter again, this time at the supper, if I do not wash you, you will have no part of me." And then he goes ahead and washes the feet of Peter. And Jesus says to them all, "As I have done for you, so now also you should do for one another." In other words, do this in memory of me. And why do we memorialize this particular action? And it's because our entire relationship with God, between God and human beings, is one of receiving love and giving love back, whatever the cost might be. If Peter will not allow Jesus to care for him in this very earthly manner, he will be refusing God's work on his behalf. Peter would be saying, you cannot love us in this way because it doesn't seem godly. He was trying to configure God's love being expressed for us in his mini mind, let's say, his very small mind, where the immensity of God's love extends from the littlest of things to the greatest of things. And Jesus' action to Peter, his reaction to Peter is like saying, I do not want to be godly in the way you imagine. I want to show you that only humility can love and be loved. Do you know, have you ever been uneasy when somebody wants to do something for you? You know them that well. Oh, no, please don't do that for me. Don't do that for me. I can do it myself. That's another American thing. But here it is, the humility to have someone care for us in a very unexpected way. And to be able to accept it and to respond positively to that. This is the lesson being taught to Peter. Do this in memory of me. Break bread and pour wine and identify them with the body and blood of the Lord. We've been doing this for almost 2,000 years. How's it going? There's a story about a little girl who's sitting on her grandfather's lap as he reads her a bedtime story. And from time to time, what she does is she'd take her eyes off the book and she would stroke his cheek and reach up into, you know, the wrinkles and all that. And she was alternately stroking her own cheek and then his again. And finally, she spoke up, Grandma, did God make you? He says, yes, sweetheart, he did it a long time ago. She says, oh, and then she paused and said, Grandpa, did God make me too? And he says, yes, indeed, honey, God made you just a little while ago. And feeling their respective faces again, she observed, God's getting better at it, isn't he? Question, are we getting better at it? If breaking bread is to be in his memory, do it as a gesture that's preceded by the washing of feet, as an action that summarizes a life of service and sacrifice and giving. There were two extraordinary scandalous gestures on that Passover, the one of washing the feet and the one of identifying his body and his blood, body, and with the bread and the wine. And there are many people who don't go to church and very often use it as an excuse to say, they're a bunch of hypocrites. Because sometimes they see the lack of union between breaking bread and service. There's a gap in the worship and in the service. But does that mean nobody is worthy to receive the Eucharist and to continue to break bread in his memory, even when there are gaps in between what we celebrate and then how we serve? And I think we can take a look at the Last Supper, where we have two disciples of Jesus, and both will betray him, both Judas and Peter. They're there. And both, as you know, they are offered by Jesus the bread of communion, to dip your bread in this water. And Peter took it, and Judas did not. And why did Jesus offer Judas the bread that was dipped? It wasn't to shame him. It wasn't to out him as a betrayer. The bread that's offered, and this is in the Eucharist today as it was in the Last Supper, it offers reconciliation. It offers our salvation, our wholeness with God and with Christ's body. And strangely, the Gospel of John tells us that when Judas went out
It was dark. Dark with a full moon, because the Passover at Jesus' time, full moon. And when Judas goes out, it is dark. The darkness was not the atmosphere. Darkness because Judas had closed himself off from the salvation remembered and offered that night. Keeping the memory of Jesus alive is not a matter of historical anniversaries. We are the words with which God's story is told. The light of Jesus continues to burn in this world only with the oil of our own lives. We are given the Spirit and called to witnesses, to be witnesses to the risen Lord of God in our midst. Remember, foot washing and bread breaking, they go together, not only at the Last Supper, but throughout our lives, not just under the Passover moon, but every day. Remember that every Eucharist is truly in memory of Him. Know that amen is sometimes the most dangerous word we can say.
Thank you.
night before he suffered, Jesus commanded us to care for our sisters and brothers. Mindful of this mandate, let us pray for each other that we may all be one in Christ.
For the church, that we may be bound more closely together as the body of Christ, we pray to the Lord. That nations throughout the earth renew their commitment to peace and justice, we pray to the Lord. For all who participate in these sacred mysteries, that they embrace the new commandment and always strive to love one another, we pray to the Lord. That by our love, care, and concern, we may humbly wash the feet of others, we pray to the Lord. For those who have died in the peace of Christ, especially Rita Lockhead and all souls in purgatory, that they may be admitted to the company of saints, and may those who mourn their loss be comforted, we pray to the Lord. That all our needs, deep in the silence of our hearts, both spoken and unspoken, be known to God, we pray to the Lord.
Loving God, we thank you for the gift of your Son who left us this memorial sacrifice as a reminder of his great love. Make us worthy of such a gift and bring us safely to the promise of your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, through Jesus the Christ. For he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong. And as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before. before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed sisters and brothers, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
And now with hearts that long for the fullness of God's kingdom, we pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
With the kingdom, power, and glory of yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer to those near us some gesture of our peace and grace.
For those of you viewing this Mass at home, let us pray. My Jesus, I believe that you are in this blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at me spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you. I unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We now have our Eucharistic procession. We begin by processing through the church. And so if you would wait before you leave until the altar service and I finish the procession, and then you can follow us to Father Bergen Hall, where we will repose the Eucharist, and there will be time for Eucharistic adoration.
During the procession, please join with me in singing number 6 in today's Missal, Ave Lingua Gloriosi, in English. Oh, page 21.
Honor the Lord, save.
Come into your kingdom.